That's a dog.
Oh.
Yeah. That's a dog. You come to the dog, look. It's a doggy. Nice. It's a dog.
For the first several months of life, infants are slaves to gravity. They're just stuck in whatever place somebody put them in. And then this remarkable transformation happens when babies learn to crawl. Now they can move their own body from one place to another, and now the whole wider world is opened up to them. But how is it that babies learn to crawl? And what do they learn when they're crawling around in the world?
In the first year of life, babies are growing faster than they ever will.
Venga, venga, que tú puedes.
The baby can wake up in a different body than they went to sleep in. It's longer, the arms are longer, the legs are longer, and as they begin to move, they cannot do exactly what they could do yesterday with the same precision. What does this mean for a baby who's learning to crawl?
For decades, we really believe that crawling was just a stage toward walking. But could crawling be more than a stage? Could crawling be fundamental to the way we all move?
Ready? Who's that?
Take a video for Mum.
Now that Amelia's back at work, I kick into my primary carer role. Bing. In earnest.
Who's that? Is that Pasco? There's Dad. There's Pasco.
Which I'm really excited about, just because it's a great time I get to spend with Pasco. And we're going to get back to practicing some tummy time, see how he's doing with crawling.
Ready? Who's this here?
When Rich starts telling me, oh, we did this today, and oh, Pasco started crawling today, or he did this new.
Get your arms going. That's it. That's it. Who's there?
And I'm sort of sat at work, just at my laptop.
Oh, boy.
You know, I'll feel like I'm missing out on quite a bit.
Oh. Hey!
I think also as a first-time mum, you're quite keen to sort of tick off all the milestones, and you sort of read the books that say at this stage your baby will be doing this, and you're, oh, my baby's not doing that, or my baby did that 2 months ago, is he too early?
Good, he's got it. First past the post. Oh, and you even pressed stop on the video, good boy. You know how it works. You know how it works.
My career is not a straightforward, I always say, trail. Not at all. I started to be a nuclear physicist. I was studying as a movement of electrons and atoms. And then as a biologist, I switched to be more interested with the movement of the body. All of these steps give me an open mind to different ideas that you can have about movement. Many people thought for a long time that crawling emerged only around 8-10 months and is a transitory step toward walking. However, it is maybe more mysterious. think for me the question was, could crawling be more than a stage? Could crawling be crucial to the way all humans move around?
Bonjour, je peux me servir?
Je prends un café, okay. Un espresso, si ça me
va. Ça marche.
Merci.
C'est moi.
In the womb, fetuses are able to move from one place to another place if they want. And you have to imagine a newborn as an astronaut coming back from the moon, where it was able to do a lot of movements freely, and now is stuck with the gravity. But there are specific time or occasion where you can see a newborn moving his body from one place to another. Around 1 hour after birth, if the baby is skin to skin on the belly of the mother, you will see the newborn moving slowly to the breast of the mother. And this is a fantastic behavior. I love it. I saw it a lot, many, many times. So another occasion is to put the newborn in the water. First time that I saw that, I was just shocked. I said, my God, this newborn are able to do a lot of things, and they are already able literally to crawl in the water. And so it is where I get very interested with this movement and starting to ask, is this crawling that is already here really disappear to reemerge 8 or 10 months later for the baby to learn how to do that on land? Or is there a link between these two behaviors, the newborn and the older baby? People believe that newborn movements are only reflexes that will disappear very soon after birth. And so they have nothing to do with a connection coming from the brain to control the movement. But with that newborn, crawling was so beautiful. It's not really an automatic system. It could not be. This is why we thought of a very crazy experiment. So the question we asked was relatively simple. Was the crawling that we saw in the newborn already controlled with something in the brain? In one of the stimulus of the brain, one of the most important systems that control the crawling at 7, 8 months is the vision.
Bonjour.
Ça va, vous avez fait bon voyage?
Oui, très bien.
Qu'est-ce qu'il a grandi?
Super.
So knowing the importance of vision, we were wondering, and this was really our big question, what will happen to newborn if we give them the illusion that they are moving around? Voilà. Will they move? Will they not move?
On a oublié son petit chapeau.
C'est un chapeau de cosmonaute, ça. Hop là. Et voilà, partir dans l'espace.
C'est exactement ça. On va le mettre dans l'espace.
What we have done is to imagine black dots that are moving on a pattern that is completely white. So to get the impression of moving, you have to have all the dots moving and in the same direction.
Allez, en route.
As soon as they see, they move their legs and their arms and literally swimming in the air.
We were just shocked when we saw that. We had this idea, but we were not completely sure that we will get this, you know, result. We were very surprised.
Bonjour, mademoiselle. Hop là. Hop là.
This for us was really something incredible because that means that they have this primitive link between the brain and the spine and the vision and the motoric activity to say, hello, I see something and I am moving according to what I see. And this was for us really the first evidence that this crawling pattern that you see at birth is coming from the brain. C'est qu'ici vous avez une extension de la jambe en même temps qu'une flexion, hop, vous voyez, du coude et de, enfin du bras. Now, having seen this baby just swimming literally in air with the arms and legs, and this definitely shows that this crawling pattern that a lot of people believe was just a reflex is not a reflex.
C'est magnifique. Ooh, gros baillon. Comment t'enlever ton chapeau deux minutes. Voilà. Il y a des papas maman. Où est-ce qu'ils sont papas maman?
We started to think of how to study and analyze the same kind of movement if we put them on land. We knew that it's very difficult for babies to propel themselves because the head is very heavy, it's one third of the weight of the body. So they are not able to support that in the gravity.
Je peux entrer?
Oui.
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Oh. Alors, veux-tu me?
So now we start about thinking how to make the baby free to move around and how to find a tool finally for them to be not crushed by the gravity and having the arms and legs free to move.
Je vous demandais si vous seriez d'accord pour participer à cette étude qui va durer, on va dire, 10 minutes, un peu plus le temps d'amener Elmi en bas au niveau moins 1.
Allez. So, we were thinking a lot about how to construct such a tool. We thought it will be easy to do it, but not at all. It took us like 1 or 2 years to build this kind of tool. So, we start to test our first baby on this mini skateboard in 2016, and we call the final version the crawly skate.
Non, ils regardent. Hein?
Ils sont confortables. Hein? Des fois, ça se déclenche. Ils font comme ils veulent. Hein?
We explain what is a crawly skate, and all the time they are very interested because the things their newborn cannot at all crawl.
Ouais. Hop, hop, hop. Voilà.
Some baby are making a huge movement, even cross the mattress once or two or three times. It's really incredible.
Wow! Bravo! Bravo! Bravo!
We were just shocked to see that this little today's newborn baby were able to do that on our crawly skate.
C'est très émouvant, je trouve. Moi, à chaque fois, je les vois bouger comme ça, ça me hein?
Trop bien.
It was really a very emotional moment.
can tell you. Not only for us, but for the parents. If we look at the results we obtain with the Crowley scale, what that suggests is that the nervous system that is important for the baby to move the arms and legs and crawl and to propel themselves is already in place. So what we have found is very new and controversial. Because for decades, people believe that we are born as bipeds. That means that we are walking only with our two legs. But what we have found is completely different picture. We believe now that we are born moving arms and legs as quadrupeds. If you look at adult walking, it seems to be automatic to move our arms when we are walking. But in fact, we can do much more than that. We are still quadrupeds inside us, in the nervous system. So, is crawling just a transitory stage? I think now, no. In fact, if you see the baby as a car, the engine is like sleeping or waiting for the body work to be ready for the moment where the baby will be strong enough with strong muscle to take care of the weight and to be motivated to move also. For that, the baby will have to grow. And this is another story of how the baby grew up and changed the body with maturation and experience. Huh?
Hey.
Oh, what a yawn. Good boy. All right, shall we see if he can do the crawl?
Come on. Oh, bit of a climb. Oh, there's a push. Use those legs. Come on. Good boy. Oh, good boy. Oh.
And that's it.
You little champion.
Push up. Good boy.
Oh, hello.
Good Very boy. Good.
Good boy.
Lift yourself up. Oh, look at that.
Just getting a bit happier staying on his front.
Yeah, you got that to play with.
Pasco does seem a little bit unsettled during the day. Probably he's just going through a bit of a growth spurt or a developmental spurt. He seems to just be getting longer and longer and stronger and stronger.
You could do it. That's it.
He's got the legs going, the legs are pumping.
He's getting bigger, that's for sure. He's got some good power in his legs, and I think he's starting to feel that in his feet.
Okay. Oh, good work, buddy.
I think we thought that he would be crawling by now, so
we'll start crawling if you'd like. Would you like to start crawling?
I started out in anthropology with an interest in the interaction that babies had with their families. Every parent experiences how disruptive babies can be. They're sleeping, and then there's no way they will go to sleep. There are times where they're not very hungry and times when they become very hungry. Or out of nowhere, they become kind of morphed. And parents will say, who's this monster who yesterday was such a good little girl? It occurred to me that knowing something about growing would be informative here. In 1979, my neighbor was about to have a baby. And I suggested to her at some point, would you mind if we measured your baby? She was very kind and she said, yes, of course.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, should we see how long you are?
Measuring a baby's length is a two-person job.
Are you ready? Set, measure!
Whoopsie!
You have somebody who can focus the attention of the infant correctly, and then you need somebody to actually stretch the baby out.
Excellent, Aspen. Thank you so much.
Very good job.
I very clearly remember that I was a little concerned about doing it, but we did it. And I wrote the measurement down. It was 62.7 centimeters. Next day, I come back, and we go through the process again, take the measurement. It was very different.
64.5.
I thought that can't be, because yesterday it was 62.7 centimeters, but today it's 64.5 centimeters. My first reaction was, well, I'm really terrible at this. I mean, I'm terrible at this because that's way too much. I came back several more times. And each time we measured the baby, the length of the baby was 64.5 centimeters. Now I was actually quite unnerved because there was no growth. I've just taken five measurements, none of which are what you would expect to see. One is too much, and then there's no growth at all, and that's not possible. How much of my data reflect the fact that I don't know what I'm doing because I'm new and I'm a novice? And how much of this might be a moment of who knew? And that's where I began.
Hey, Bubba. Hey, Mateo. Yeah, you're smiling now. Your sleep has been more difficult lately, hasn't it? And Mama's very tired. What else is going on with you? He's going through a growth spurt. And there have been moments where Mateo has just like randomly just burst out into hysterical crying. There's been no particular reason for it. Yeah, you're lucky you're so cute. Yeah, you're lucky you're so cute and that I love you. Because you've been a handful. Yes, you have. Yes, you have. You've been more difficult with your naps. Yes. You don't want to sit down for too long. Yeah, you want to pull yourself up. Yes, you do.
Don't get upset.
Yeah, I know you don't like to lay down. Okay, it's okay. He's definitely taking more attention now. He wants more attention now. Which is harder to get things done in the house.
Mateo.
We used to think that babies grew every day, little by little, slowly, very slowly, that it was a kind of background noise of life. There's a growth chart in every pediatrician's office, so every parent has seen their child's size plotted on a growth chart. These particular charts show the size of 882 children that were measured at ages 1 week, 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and then monthly thereafter until 1 year of age. When we look at a growth chart, we see a curve. But the curves are actually a result of a connect the dots process. There were no measurements between these two specific time points, but it creates the visual image of how growth occurs very slowly and continuously through time. Is it actually continuous, little by little, every day, as we all assume it is? I set out to measure 30 babies, because 30 babies would be a reasonable scientific size. Also, when I started measuring babies, I asked parents to please keep a record of their baby's behavior on a day-to-day basis. These notebooks are the original data. This was a typical day in my life on the 23rd of August in 1981. I visited 12 children, and for each of them, I measured at least their head and their length. I met the first family at 7:20 in the morning. I remember that quite precisely. And I saw the last person on this page. I left their house at 10 p.m. It looks simple, but that's what it took to do the measurements. I noticed that babies who were measured once a week did grow in the course of a week. This led me to wonder, did it really take a whole week for that growth to occur? I decided to measure them twice weekly, and I noticed that babies grew in half a week. And I thought, does it really take them one half of a week to grow? And that moment is when I first started measuring babies daily. Scientifically, it was a remarkable experience because I did not know what we would find. On the 19th of February in 1986, this child was 59.8 centimeters. Next day, the length measurement for this child was 59.8 centimeters. The following day, the child was 59.8 centimeters. And one day later, the child was 60.8 centimeters. So in this one day, the child was 1 centimeter longer. Among the babies I measured every day, their growth varied between 0.5 centimeter and 1.65 centimeters. In one 24-hour period, in one day, they grew. And these growth days were separated from one another in an individual by 2 to 28 days of no growth. And then these bursts, these spurts, occurred. From these records, I was also able to identify a clear link between the times during which they were having a growth spurt and dramatic changes in babies' behavior, changes in their sleeping behavior, tantrums, and times of insatiable hunger. Wow, I was thinking, this is a very big thing. I was shocked. I was awed. I thought this was remarkable. And it was a moment of, I have no idea how this happens, but these are the data. So what we used to think is that growth happened in a curve. And what we now can see is that growth happens in jumps that separate times of no growth. Two very distinctive phases. And the reason that we can see this now is because of the increased frequency in the measurements themselves. The day that the paper was published, it was on the front page of the New York Times, the Washington Post, and it hit a number of media outlets. There was a genuine interest. This is remarkable. Isn't that exciting that we now know this about children? What I did not expect was the reaction from the scientific community. I was invited to a conference, and I had a few very nice, very sensible questions. And then a leading figure in the field stood up and started by mocking the data that this can't be. Don't we all know this can't be, because look at the growth curve. That this wasn't credible, that it stretched their imagination that babies could grow so much in one day. It simply wasn't possible. I was not prepared for that level of rancor at all, just not at all. But I think it's an example of when one has a model in one's mind, a model of how things work. This is classic in science. And somebody comes and says, well, wait a minute, let's consider this. The reaction to that is very frequently a kind of hostile disbelief. But I think it's absolutely consistent with how science progresses. Understanding that the baby is experiencing its own growth and that its body is changing and it has to adjust to its own changing body and where it is in space and what it can do is a very different way of thinking about the influences on early development. What does this mean for a baby who's learning to crawl?
Ready? 1, 2, 3. And then they just stand up. Is that funny?
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
There's Pasco.
Hello, Paxi.
So we've been doing loads of tummy time.
Oh, has he?
But Daddy. Not showing Daddy. Much signs of wanting to crawl.
Wow.
Well, the toys look great, but he doesn't.
Yeah.
He'll try and reach for things, but his feet don't move.
He kind of happily goes on his tummy for a bit, but then he's gets really annoyed.
Really worth persisting with that Mimi, though. It's terribly important for them to crawl and to use all those muscles, because that's really important for their future development, you know.
Get those legs going.
It's just hard when he really hates tummy time and is really upset. Yeah. It's hard to keep doing it.
Do you think you want to crawl, mate? Gemma says you have to.
he shook his head. No. No, I don't want to.
No. Cheeky boy.
I can definitely see where she's coming from with her concerns, but there's not much you can do with a baby. You can try telling him so many times, you need to crawl before you walk, but if that's what he wants to do.
I haven't always been a scientist. In college, I actually studied fine art. And on the first day of class, the professor handed me a plant. And he said, draw this. Every day, he would come with a different plant, and he would tell me, you need to really look at it and understand how it grows. So now, all these years later, I feel like I'm essentially doing the same thing, only now I'm looking at babies and I'm looking at their movements so that I can understand how does behavior grow. In the real world, the ground is not perfectly flat and empty and uniform. But for the last 100 years and even going on now today, people study infant crawling by encouraging the babies to crawl in a straight line over uniform ground. But that's not how real mobility works. In the real world, as babies are crawling around, they actually have to make decisions. They have to use perception to guide their crawling movements. So, you know, should I crawl over the edge of the bed or should I stop at the edge? And so I wanted to find a way to test how do babies use perception to guide their crawling movements. If a baby really could perceive what they can do and what they cannot do, then they should be able to do it in a totally novel situation, something that they've never encountered before. So I built an adjustable slope apparatus. So for this study, we want to see how babies know what actions are possible and what actions are not. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to ask him to crawl over this walkway.
Great.
It's going to make a noise, Grant. It can have really small slopes like this.
Yep.
Or steeper ones like that.
Gotcha. Good. I love it.
All right, kiddo, let's go. Grant is about 10 months old, and he's been crawling for a little over a month.
Come get Luca.
Come here.
Grant, come get these.
Yeah.
Good job. Oh, you got it.
We increase the degree of slant 6 degrees at a time.
All right, Grant, are you ready?
Come here.
Go.
We're trying to figure out how precise are the baby's decisions about what they can and cannot do. On a successful trial, he crawls from top to bottom, belly off the floor, and nobody has to touch him. On an unsuccessful trial, his arms give out, or he stumbles, or, you know, he's about to do a face plant on the surface, and the experimenter has to rescue him.
Hi. We're waking them all up.
Come here.
You gonna put him down to sleep? And put him to sleep?
Okay. It's good.
Good try.
He's making judgments that are completely off from what he really can do. And then finally, we present them with the largest slope, which is really a 90-degree drop-off.
Okay, okay. Go. It's all the way down there. You gotta go get it.
You coming?
All right! Good try, man.
Grant approached the 90-degree drop-off the same way as he was approaching the shallower slopes. Come over to the edge, look and see what's at the bottom.
The puppet
balls. And then just crawl right over the edge.
All right!
That's telling us that Grant is not yet able to distinguish what he can do and what he cannot do. It's absolutely typical that babies, when they first begin crawling, when they first begin any new skill, they just are willing to try everything. And it's actually a pretty good way for development to work. If you don't try things, you're never gonna learn. And so they just take the leap.
Go.
Yeah. Marlo's interesting because she's quite a strong hands and knees crawler.
Down you come.
Good. Hi, Marlo.
terms of having alternative ways of coping with a difficult motor problem, she was like right on the edge of understanding that, you know, there was other positions that are available to her to solve the problem.
Come here. You can do it.
Babies show really differing kinds of behaviors as they're approaching the brink of an impossibly steep slope.
Come on down. I know, it's so funny. Just come on down.
The babies who make smart decisions, those are the same babies that will generate perceptual information by looking and by touching.
See it. Can you come in?
Marla was quite good at perceiving what she could and could not do. She knew if the slopes were very steep that they were impossible.
Xylophone! Yeah! Wee!
Hey.
Good. Good try, man.
All right. Okay, can I send this down to Justine?
I'll hold it for you.
Ducks would switch freely between crawling on hands and knees and crawling on hands and feet like a bear.
Get a little more challenging.
He actually can move faster when he's up on hands and feet. And so when he really wanted to get to something, he would just extend his legs and, you know, crawl down the pathway on hands and feet.
Crawling, what's that?
He was just, you know, reconfiguring his body on the fly to kind of figure out how to solve that problem.
Let's do it again.
Perfect. All right, you coming down?
Ready? We'll build this tall tower for you.
Dax really, really could perceive the limits of his own abilities. So as the slope started to get too steep for him to crawl safely, that's when he was beginning to switch to find alternative strategies.
Ready? Come get some down here. Yeah, they're all waiting for you.
Wow! Smart thinking.
Got it.
It takes about 20 weeks of crawling experience before a baby is showing adult-like accuracy when they're looking at an impossibly steep slope. What is it that babies are learning over all those weeks of crawling?
Definitely not in Manhattan. Good job.
Good job.
They're learning how to figure out in this moment, right now, what is my body like? What is the environment like? And what can I do with this body in this environment? And those things will change from day to day because they can wake up and find that they've grown another 2 centimeters. Their mom could dress them in a different outfit that is functionally changing their body dimensions or the way that they can move.
Go, go, go.
And it's good for your baby to crawl on grass or crawl on sand or crawl on whatever, because learning to crawl isn't learning some specific pattern of coordination between your arms and legs. It's learning to behave in a really flexible way so that the baby can get around in the world.
Tummy time again? Huh? What are you doing, tummy time?
Is that a laugh or is that a cry? Mateo, is that a laugh or a cry?
Where's Maya? Yeah, you don't like this position. Are you gonna crawl, Mateo? Did you come crawl?
He just started crawling. And then as soon as he started, he's just been going nonstop ever since. So Yeah, he goes between rooms. He climbed up the stairs the other day, which I was shocked by.
Come, come, come.
And so I really have to watch him now.
Hey, come on. Come on. Hey, good boy. Hey. Good boy.
Yeah, now I really need to be careful with him because, yeah, you're all over the place, Bubs.
It's okay, come. Come, come. Come. It's okay, come.
More recently, he's getting more dependent, just kind of going for it and feeling confident to just explore on his own.
Good boy.
You're on the move, Bub.
Papa.
Over the years, I've watched hundreds and hundreds of babies crawl. One of the things that I found out, to my surprise and my frustration, was that a baby who could demonstrate that it could crawl on Monday would not be able to crawl on Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday, and then could crawl again on Friday, and then not Saturday, Sunday. So this raised the question of whether there's a long period when a baby can't crawl and then, like, turning on a light switch, all of a sudden, now this baby can crawl. Does it really work like that? Well, the only way to know would be to observe babies every single day and see whether you turned on the crawling switch.
This is my daughter, Lily. When she was a baby. And she was in my diary study, and we tracked babies from when they were born until they were about 18, 20 months old. We asked parents to track every little skill that babies might display on the way to being able to crawl. This whole file is Lily's data. So in March, Lily took her first crawling steps. So on March 19th, she did a combat crawl, and then we never saw it again. And on March 28th, she did a belly crawl, and then not again until April 1st. Now Lily is doing a whole variety of little sort of crawling steps of different types of crawls. Sometimes they go away, sometimes they stay for several days in a row. We learned that crawling is incredibly variable and incredibly creative, and that every baby's trajectory looks different from the other babies. The whole idea of motor milestones, where there's a kind of orderly progression. First babies can roll, and then they can sit up, and then they can crawl, and then they stand, and then they cruise. You know, it's been in the literature for a century. In every pediatrician's office, in every parenting book or magazine, it just really doesn't happen like that.
Non-toy toy.
He's just done the same words you've made. Or noise. Yeah. Oh. Get your balance right. That is brilliant.
Our findings show that there really is no sort of steady march from one stage to another.
Oh, success.
From whatever, lifting your head up and then all the way to walking.
Good, strong legs.
Instead, babies are acquiring their skills in different orders, and skills are sort of appearing and disappearing and reappearing, and then bit by bit, babies gradually make their way toward walking.
He's on the move, and there's no sort of turning back. I don't think he's gonna crawl. I think he's completely missed that stage.
Seeing other babies crawling and getting places, there was a bit of a thought, oh, it'd be nice if Pasco could do that. But once we got the feeling that he wasn't going to crawl, it was just, all right, just let him stand up.
Watch your head.
On the table. Here. Whoa. Where is it? Where did it go?
And he's just decided, no, I like standing up and I like moving around this way, so I'm just going to continue like this. No. No.
Yes, yes.
No? It's just evil eyes watching him all the time. Making sure he's not grabbing something that he shouldn't grab.
It's really important for parents to know that crawling isn't mandatory. It is not an obligatory stage that babies have to do before they begin walking. And so if your baby decides to crawl, great.
It's 40.
And if your baby finds another solution for getting around, like bum shuffling, great. And if your baby decides to just wait and get up and walk, that's also great.
That's
good
it.
Cruise, good cruise.
That's it.
Yes. Reach.
Oh,
get
almost.
Closer. Good boy.
Babies all develop in their own way.
One hand.
Hey. So just relax and enjoy and watch your baby's beautiful development.